Our speaker today is Professor Stephen Collicott. He earned his PhD in aeronautics and astronautics from Stanford University, is an associate fellow of the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, chairs the Sub-orbital Applications Research Group of the Commercial Spaceflight Federation, and serves on the Committee on Biological and Physical Sciences in Space for the National Academies. At Purdue, he teaches and does research in the area of zero-gravity fluid dynamics. Now in his 27th year at Purdue, he also serves as Associate Head for Engagement in the School of Aeronautics and Astronautics. And here to enlighten us all on what zero-gravity fluid dynamics is all about and why it is important is Dr. Stephen Collicott. Professor, the microphone is yours.
Thank you, Roy, and thank you, everybody, for having me here. I like to walk around a bit, I think, when I talk, so I'll come out in front of the podium. It's great to be here in town. I've been here 26 years, and I do have to say, when I got here 26 years ago, I received great guidance in the School of Aeronautics and Astronautics from Gus.
Good old Gus.
So thank you, Gus. And hopefully he won't be sitting there going, oh, what did I help this guy do? So thanks for having me. Let's start with, I've got two little videos, and we may fuss a little with the audio on the first, but we'll have it tuned up here. This is silent here. At Purdue University. Thanks to Blue Origin, I will fly an original experiment in two-phase fluid dynamics, that is, a liquid and a gas, in a test vessel. When a spacecraft's liquid propellant system or life support system is in zero gravity, capillary action, or wicking, is the dominant force on the liquid, causing liquid to settle and stay in one place in a container or to wick off to another place. This new experiment is built around a spherical test vessel. A reservoir holds the liquid until it is needed. LED panels illuminate the experiment, and two video cameras record views of the liquid behavior. The ability to predict these two behaviors is very important to the design of successful, safe, affordable, and dependable spaceflight systems. The experiment was funded by an eager grant from the National Science Foundation. Thus, I'm very happy to lead a Purdue team on their remarkable New Shepard vehicle. So that was a short one that that company I mentioned in their Blue Origin had me put together for an experiment we flew with them in June. And this is an odd name, perhaps, Blue Origin. Well, their feeling is Earth is the where we start, and it's blue. So hence the name for a company interested in space exploration. So we flew in June. This is their current market is suborbital, that is going up and down. That's really a far simpler task than going up higher and fast enough, like 17,000 miles an hour, to go around and around in orbit. So this is not up to space station, this is not up to Hubble telescope or anything. This is up and down flights, which are coming online for space tourism. They're a little pricey right now. About a quarter million. But it's a great, I'm very active in showing that these new tourist vehicles are actually unique new research and education platforms. And so the next video here is our flight in June. Okay, I was not in it. I was standing on the ground watching this unmanned rocket fly.
Welcome to all our viewers from around the globe to the first ever Blue Origin launch webcast. It's a beautiful day down here in Texas.
T-minus 10, 9. 8, 7, 6, 5, 4. Command and start. 2, 1.
Coming up in a couple seconds. here will hit max Q. This is the point where aerodynamic stresses on the vehicle are at its max.
You don't see much of a plume with this engine, and that's because the propellants are liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen. So it's actually a very clean burn.
It's the fourth flight of this new Shepard rocket.
We're now at Mach 3, 150,000 feet.
There we go. Eco. Main engine cutoff.
Right on target.
There it is, separation. Jeff, at this point, if you were there in the crew capsule, you're going to start feeling that weightlessness. You're going to start to unbuckle. Do your somersaults.
Start doing somersaults. Look out that window. You can definitely see the blackness of space from there. 10,000 feet. That engine should be relighting soon. 5,000 feet. There's that engine. Let's cut over to the crew capsule because it's about to deploy its parachutes.
There we go. We've got the two drone chutes which have deployed.
That means we are executing the primary mission of today's flight, which was to test the redundancy with our parachutes. There go the main parachutes. 1,000 feet off the ground. Going to be that retro rocket system that fires just in the last second before touchdown. Keep in mind it does kick up a lot of dust here in the West Texas desert. It looks like a hard landing, but really it just is a soft, pillowy touchdown at about 1 or 2 miles an hour. 100 feet.
Touchdown.
Wow.
Beautiful.
Picture perfect. That's exactly what we want.
Oh, that was magic. Well, on behalf of all the hardworking team at Blue Origin, thank you for joining us today, everybody on the internet, for our live broadcast of our new Shepard rocket flight. If you're interested in learning more and keeping up to date with our progress, please be sure to sign up on our website for email updates. And until next time, good on Frost.
Okay, so that was a big thrill for me. They gave me that launch back in 2009. They asked me to propose an experiment for their flying their flight test program. And they wanted the Purdue name involved with their work. They've hired a lot of our graduates in my School of Aeronautics and Astronautics. That whole company is funded by Jeff Bezos of Amazon.com fame and wealth. So that's his hobby, that's his contribution to advancing spaceflight. And certainly he's had great things to say publicly about Purdue, and we're grateful for that. So here's two of my students with me. About an hour after the booster landed. This is out in West Texas. Fly to El Paso, drive east an hour and a half, and Bezos owns a big chunk of the state there. So it's his ranch. And so, like I said, June 19th this year. This was the fourth successful flight of that booster and that crew capsule. They had a fifth one in October, and now that vehicle's retired and they're starting up again this year. Here we are with the crew capsule afterwards. The next one, those gray rectangles, are going to be windows for tourists, the largest windows in spaceflight history. And you can see here, I'll walk in front point, with this brush here and the other scrub grass around the bottom, that's a pretty gentle landing, actually. You know, it didn't clear out a blast zone or anything. So it'll be pretty comfy for future tourists. So, zero gravity fluid dynamics. It's really an everyday event. We're just not aware of it usually. So, because in modern life, we depend on satellites for everyday commerce, everyday communications, weather forecasting, annual crop production, emergency management. You know, with mistaking words, I was looking at Roy's email to me. I thought it said please come give a lazy man's description. So I thought I can do that. It wasn't until I got the glasses, new glasses from Dr. Kirchner, that I saw a layman's production. So. All right, we're finished with the video audio, so I turned that off. So in order to succeed in this mission or maximize profitable lifetime, each of these satellites consumes liquid rocket propellants in orbit. And so how do you manage this? How do you gauge it? How do you tell how much satellite is left in the spacecraft? How do you tell how much fuel is left in the spacecraft when it's 23,000 miles up? That's the type of work we work on. So it's, like I say, it's an everyday event. So here's an example of how bizarre it can be. This is a space station experiment I had the pleasure of being invited to design. This is sped up 64 times. It's a 2-hour experiment, so it's going to be about a 2-minute video. And this launched July 4th of 2006 and was operated by a number of astronauts in space station. That was a big thrill to be involved with. But this is just, whole thing here is about the size of a travel coffee mug. There's a lot of details there, but the way liquid behaves in, that red liquid behaves in zero gravity of wicking up a corner or not wicking up a corner, and why one side of the container dried out and why the other side keeps liquid in it. That same physics happens here in, on Earth, but the gravity is so strong that it just gets overwhelmed. We never see it. So there's not magical new physics up there, it's just that the dominant effect here on Earth, that is gravity, is taken away. And so what looks to us to be unusual physics, even though it's around us every day, takes over. So wicking here on Earth is why napkins work, towels, pick up water, a drinking straw, capillaries when you take a sample of your blood from your finger. All these things happen on Earth, and they're only relevant at very small sizes, but in orbit, they're relevant at the big size. All right. So, I like to use suborbital flights now for research in my field, but what other fields? Well, mesosphere and lower thermosphere in the atmosphere. Those are layers of the atmosphere that are above all the balloons, even the really expensive, really high 130,000 foot science balloons. They'll go from there up to around 360,000 feet. These rockets will fly. That's below all the satellites. And we know very little about that part of our atmosphere and our climate. Combustion physics, how things burn and how to make things burn cleaner, more efficiently, and fire safety in space flight. Human physiology, our bodies react to changes in the environment, such as the absence of gravity. That's typically for the body as a whole, about the first 5 minutes of space flight. Astronauts and cosmonauts, technonauts, they're all busy that first 5 minutes. So these suborbital flights actually give us a lot more opportunities to fly a lot more people into weightlessness and look at how the body responds. Cellular biology, I've seen work with cells that actually within 20 seconds of weightlessness, they change their, and this is where I'm not really smart about biology, there's a calcium signaling channel between cells, and somehow that changes even within the first half minute of weightlessness. And so 3 to 5 minutes is a long enough time. Astronomers want to get up there. Infrared astronomy, that gets you above all the water vapor in the atmosphere, so you're able to see new things. You're able to go and look at other things, for example, with a smaller telescope that you would never point the Hubble telescope within so many degrees of the sun. Whereas with smaller things, smaller, cheaper telescopes, you can go try exotic things. Particulate collisions, like in Saturn's rings, how do the rings evolve? How do, every time particles hit, do they stick together? Do they break into more smaller particles? Chemical reaction dynamics, fire safety, spaceflight medical procedures we're involved in now. Future space, long duration spaceflight, NASA has a list of medical procedures they want to be able to perform. Spaceflight technology readiness on these television satellites, for example, it's a $200 million satellite, another $100 million roughly to launch it, and then the revenue is several billion dollars over its lifetime, and insurance companies are very reluctant to let you put new technology on a satellite until it's proven
in space. Well, how can you prove it in space if you can't get it installed? Well, these suborbital flights now are actually a very affordable way to do that, and so that's going to be a big thing. Sensor testing, just talking to some people who are talking about having a weather radar looking down will give them so much better, so much more information on surface winds that this group says they can move tornado warnings from minutes to an hour with all that data. Earth observation for agriculture and emergencies, all kinds of things going on. Educational payloads. If spaceflight gets cheap enough, we could fly educational payloads. That'd be cool. Anyway, I do all this not alone. I wanted to say countless Purdue Aero Astro grad and undergrad students, my employer, and then Armadillo Aerospace, Blue Origin, Exos, X-Core, Mastin have all given me flights for my payloads because they want the Purdue name involved, and parts of NASA and many of our young alums donate for travel. So you heard who I am, and I've been involved in this field since 1981. I was a college kid then. I had a summer job with Lockheed Missiles and Space Company working on control of these propellants in satellites, and I just kind of had a passion for it since. Professional service also. I chaired this group of researchers where we will be in D.C. April 10 and 11, making visits on the Hill on the 11th, working with the FAA, working with NASA, working with Congress to try to make sure we don't regulate this new industry out of existence before it has a chance to fly. CASIS is a group that manages half the International Space Station, National Academies, and then I had the great pleasure of doing invited testimony 4 years ago to the U.S. Senate Subcommittee on Science, Space, and Competitiveness. That's me on the right. Wayne Hale on the left here is a twice-honored mechanical engineering graduate from Purdue. So we had Purdue bookends on this Senate testimony. That was Senators Nelson and Cruz that day. So besides Blue Origin, who I've been talking about, and getting my research into there, there's others who want to become your suborbital provider. Virgin Galactic is in the news a lot. Richard Branson, I think, is very good at getting the media to do his publicity for him for free. And this is a shot of their first vehicle in flight during flight tests. They unfortunately lost that one and one of the pilots with it. In October of 2014. But a year ago, I was invited to the rollout of their new spaceship out in Mojave, California. There it is. And what a great day that was. I thought I was going out to have fun, and I ended up making a good new connection for Purdue. One of our alums had quietly become president of a company just down the runway from this company, and now he's very active with Purdue. A very young company president. So they rolled this new one out a year ago. It's largely the same as the previous one. There's some improvements hidden in there. They're back in flight test. Now they've done a couple or three gliding flights, and this has a pilot, a co-pilot, and six spaceflight participants or tourists, or pilot, co-pilot, and one to six researchers with their science, product development payloads, educational payloads, or up to six automated payloads. You don't necessarily have to have people up there. There's also Mastin Space Systems in Mojave, California, and they've built lunar lander type vehicles that take off and land vertically. And they've stumbled into a nice new market flying left to right, as I call it, rather than up and down. People working entry, descent, and landing research for future Mars or Saturn moon missions or other planets or asteroids now have a test bed they can use every day to test out sensors and control systems and control algorithms and decision making on landing in rocky environments and unmapped landing and unmapped surfaces and that sort. So they're flying a lot. And what's a lot for spaceflight? Well, let's see. If you drive your car a lot, that might be a half dozen trips a day. Here's their 10-day average for flight rates over the last 6 years. In 10 days, they've occasionally reached over 100 flights. they're flying a lot. This is a lot. This is more rocket flights than the rest of history put together, pretty much. This is what is going to bring down the cost of research on these rockets. Exos, the first was called Armadillo, and then they said, well, an armadillo can't cross the highway successfully. Why would we name a rocket after it? Actually, they got new financing, but they liked that joke. It was started by a video game millionaire. It was his hobby, big rockets, and now it's moved into about to become a business. So this is no people, right? If you want to make a cheap rocket, don't fly people. Goodness sakes, we're expensive. Taking care of us in space, that's expensive. So they said, well, get the expensive thing off the rocket. And this is fully reusable, green propellant, so there's ethanol and liquid oxygen. If you have a spill, liquid oxygen vaporizes and goes right back to where it came from. And the ethanol, you just hose down, dilute it, and it's fine. So this is that's one way to bring down the cost of operations, is to have non-toxic propellants. So it's about 20 inches diameter, gentle boost, GPS-guided parafoil returns the payload right back to the researchers at the end of the flight. So this is really ideal for research. They had some good success. This was a picture taken from 93 kilometers altitude. And if you become a space tourist with Virgin Galactic or Blue Origin, this is what you're going to see. This is the altitude you're headed to. So that'd be pretty cool. X-Core is building a winged rocket plane and with pilot and one passenger. But about a year ago, Memorial Day last year, they had some layoffs and vehicle work was paused. That's the flight vehicle there getting built. And they're focusing on things in their product line which already bring in revenue. They're a business, right? Pumps, cryogenic pumps, things like that. They're making money. So we hope they're going to fly, but we're sitting around waiting. Okay. Now, a lot of people talk to me about why are they taking so long in flight test. And I have to answer that flight test is, by design, a most deliberate process. Okay. It's intended to uncover surprises. Why do people have surprises in flight tests? Well, that's the purpose of flight test, to find those surprises, and those surprises do mean schedule delays. And if you enjoy safe commercial airline travel around the country, you'd be hypocritical to complain about the pace of flight test, because you are benefiting from this slow, methodical flight test in those aircraft developments. So the rocket companies, yes, they're slow in flight test. Everybody's slow in flight test. All right. So here's what I talked about, that working with a medical research company, Orbital Medicine out in Virginia. One of the things NASA wants to be able to do is to treat a collapsed lung in long-duration spaceflight. And that requires chest suction. And making a little piston pump work in zero gravity is just fine. That's no problem. The pump works right side up, upside down, throw it, kick it, whatever you want to do, the pump works. The issue is what comes out of the suction. You've got, let's say, blood, and you have air. And here on Earth, that tube goes into a little bucket, and the blood sits in the bottom, and the air flies out the top because of gravity. In weightlessness, how do you get the blood and the air separated? Because you want to get that blood back in the astronaut. There's no blood bank down the hall on the third floor, okay? And all of the astronauts want the air. All right, these are both precious resources in spaceflight. And so we've been working with this company, Orbital Medicine, to do this. They have a contract with NASA and are partnering with us here at Purdue. You see, it's called patient aspiration in reduced gravity is what the doctor called it. And since it's for the chest, our own project is known as thoracic part. But and the sequel is going to fly on the Blue Origin flight coming up this year. So we're scheduled for Blue Origin this year. First, we've tested in parabolic flight testing on aircraft, where you get 25 seconds of a rather bouncy zero gravity at a time. We did this in November with a company called Zero G Corp. They fly a 727 this way. My undergraduates in my class at Purdue, I have a class called Zero Gravity Flight Experiment. It's really great. We built this in class to use capillary forces to separate blood from air and weightlessness with no moving parts. Here's what it looks like in the airplane. That's me in the background against the wall. Our experiment's in back working real well. I had a chance to come up with two students and play a little. So I'm not an astronaut, but I get to play one on the weekends. And so Sasha and Wills were part of the student team that had put this experiment together and made it work well. So I talked about education payloads. This one, Zero Gravity Glow Experiment, is going to fly with Thoracic Parg, the sequel, on Blue Origin this year. How can a school, second grade, afford spaceflight? Okay, West Lafayette's rich, I know. Well, Blue Origin has taken one of their standard payload boxes and worked with a company called NanoRacks to break it up into small chambers, and they're selling this, and we are able to fly a second grade experiment for $5,300 into space and back. And I called Brock Tulukian one day. I said, Brock, what do you pay for football uniforms? Around here, it's about 12 grand. Some Texas high schools, it's 15 to 20 grand. So this is cheaper than football uniforms. Schools all over the country play football, right? Okay, that's not part of the school district budget. Parents and local businesses donate to the booster club. But they do that because they feel football's worthwhile, right? When parents and local businesses feel that K through 12 spaceflight is worthwhile, it's even easier than funding football. This is a huge change from about a $2.5 million NASA or European Space Agency sounding rocket in the old technology. So here with Cumberland School, Maggie Samudio's second grade class. Some of you may have been pressured by her already to talk to your state senator, talk to your state assemblyman, and help us get the SAES Firefly made, the state insect. Well, we teamed up with Maggie and her second graders for the Zero Gravity Glow Experiment. Because while they were studying their government lesson to pursue this state insecthood of SAES Firefly, then when they transitioned to a science lesson, somebody asked, will fireflies light up in the space station? Can fireflies glow in zero gravity? And so Maggie emailed me. And because of my involvement in the industry, I was able to say, well, you know, I can guess at that, but let's build an experiment and fly it. So initially it was going to be with X-Core and only 3,000, but when they put their vehicle on hold in Blue Origin, was having successful test flights, then we switched over to Blue Origin. So $5,300, again, a half to a third the cost of football uniforms. And my message here is not to stop playing football. My message we're trying to get out, lead the country into, is that any school district that can afford to play football can afford space flight, okay? These second graders are working with my Purdue students, undergraduates in aerospace engineering, to design and build this payload and make it happen, okay? So I tease my students that you haven't even graduated from Purdue and you're already obsolete. Look at these second graders. So yeah, we want to lead the country into this new age of affordable K through 12 space flight. Now my research flight's about 10 times that much, but again, compared to 2.5 million for the old way to do it, it's just really, really neat. There's demonstration hardware. We're not flying the transparent acrylic box, but that's demonstration. There's two syringes. One holds the luciferin and luciferase molecules. The other holds the power source for the glow. That's an ATP solution, just like our cells use for power. Those chemicals are mixed in the weightless period of flight. There's a high-def video camera there to record video. And that's what we'll have the glow. I think it'll glow, but we'll have the glow on video for the second graders. So, concluding, and I did grab this from an industry talk I gave, think innovatively. Spaceflight's different now. It's no longer a slow, expensive, single-shot government thing, okay? With changes direction with each new Congress and president. Spaceflight and experimentation is now a commercial thing. It's a free market thing. In a couple years, I'll be able to go to, you know, spaceflightrs.com and say, I want two Blue Origin flights, a Mastodon flight, and, you've got a sale on the X-Corp. I'll take two X-Corps on sale. This is going to be, spaceflight is for research and education and for tourism, is becoming an open market thing. It's an affordable thing, a repeatable thing. We don't get to just fly an experiment once and be done with it. We're going to be able to refly experiments and improve them and all that. And hopefully one of the big messages today, besides being a rapid thing, spaceflight's even a K-12 thing. So we early adopters showed up in 2009, and this was urging. I was at a big industry research and development conference in D.C. How people say my company doesn't do work in space. I say, I know your company hasn't done work in space because it's been slow, expensive, difficult. Now it's not. So this is the message is update your thinking or be left behind. So thanks for having me here. And I think, again, the big message is zero gravity. Physics is an everyday thing because we depend on satellites. K-12 spaceflight is cheaper than playing football. Now, I do pester the rocket companies that, yeah, well, you need to get them down to the price of the basketball uniforms, and then they'll be really happy. So thank you very much.
Questions?
Satellites are flying around up there right now?
How many satellites? I don't know exactly. I would say several thousand. Several thousand. It's big up there. I mean, there's that, compared to commercial airliners, there's probably 10,000 commercial airliners in the air every day. So, yeah, and they linger up there, a lot of them.
I think I heard that they're getting ready to send two passengers who paid in advance to go up and around the moon and come back. What's the charge for that?
I'm not sure, but getting the money up front's probably a good idea. I was once approached by a saleswoman, and I think the number was around $50 million. I told her, I'm sorry, I spent that much on my wife last week, and I just don't have another 50. I don't know who they are. The Russians, for a long time, have been saying they had one passenger sold to take a Soyuz around the moon and back, and they're looking for the second passenger. That's what somebody tried to hit me up for. I don't know why, other than we were standing around the middle of the desert launch site with nothing to do for 6 hours. But no, I wish them well. It'd be really cool. Beyond the order of $50 million is my guess.
Any other questions? Yes, Don?
What kind of changes, you were talking about medical impacts of spaceflight, what kind of changes does spending 6 months in a space station have on a human being?
Oh, I'm not really a good guy to ask. I did, Thursday night, I did meet the astronaut who spent a year up there, and his twin brother who spent the year down here, and there was talk of, I'll do the six, I'm gonna sound really ignorant now, the strip of molecules on the end of the genes that gets shorter as it divides.
Telomeres.
Yes, what was that again?
Telomeres.
Telomeres. The astronaut who spent a year in orbit has longer telomeres than his twin brother who stayed on Earth. Now, what's the impact of that? Who knows?
But they did say they're very competitive brothers since youth, and they could just picture one of them taunting the other that I have longer telomeres than
you. Didn't he come back measuring about 2 inches taller than his brother?
Yeah, everybody expands, and then you shrink back down. Your joints unload, you get longer. I've heard astronauts they lose all their calluses on the bottom of their feet because you're not walking around. You land and it's painful to walk on a rough surface, but a couple of weeks comes right back. I think the eyeball changes people are worried about right now. And then of course the big problem in long-term spaceflight is radiation damage. And one of the ways to combat that is to take the oldest astronauts. Right? So, but.
Yay!
Elon Musk, who runs SpaceX, is very vocal about his desire to go to Mars. And there's a joke going around that, everybody wants to go home,
Any more questions? One more.
You can duplicate zero gravity on Earth, right? That was the when you were in there.
The aircraft flight, right? About 20 seconds of it, it's kind of bouncy. It's not
the same thing. Because right. I was wondering if you can duplicate it here, why send the test the glow and spend all that money if you can duplicate the experiment on Earth? What would be the point of sending them into space?
Very good. We wanted the longer time in order to be able to carefully inject the chemicals. We're not taking actual fireflies. I don't know how to make them glow.
Oh, you're not doing that. I thought you were
doing... We're doing the firefly chemicals. I don't know how to make fireflies glow on command. And
I thought you were gathering them and sending them...
Actually, the chemicals we buy are from fireflies that have been gathered.
Wow.
They are the actual... The firefly chemistry, the glow chemistry is understood these days. It's an exothermic rate that gives off heat, enough heat that it excites electrons up to a higher orbit around the nucleus, and then as the electrons relax back, they give off the light. I'm told that what's not understood is how fireflies turn it on and off quickly.
Tom Turpin's going to talk to you next week. Ask
oh,
him.
Excellent.
Ask him.
Yes, he's the expert. I went down to the public TV station in Bloomington to be on a children's science show a couple years back. And that's fine, I'll do that. And they said, Professor Turpin was here a month ago. He was great. All you have to do is be like Tom Turpin. I told him there are very few people on this planet who can be like Tom Turpin. I admire him a lot. So, yeah, you guys can all... I say luciferin, luciferase, those are the molecules you say. But Professor Turpin, what about,
He'll have great. An answer, too.
He's great.
All right, thank you very much.